I ask you the question today, what would you do if Jesus showed up at your house tomorrow night? Well, a junior church teacher asked that to some children in their class, and 8-year-old Jennifer said, "I'd sit at his feet and listen to what he had to say." 10-year-old Carson said, "He could sit with me on the sofa and watch Monday Night Football. I'm pretty sure that my mom would even let him eat in the den." So it sounds like something a 10-year-old boy would say, does it not? Well, Jesus showed up at Abraham's house, but he didn't recognize who he was. It says there in verse 1 and 2, "Then the Lord appeared to him by the terebinth trees of Mamre, as he was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the night." It must have been about this time of the year, because it was in the heat of the day. "So he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing by him." So we find Jesus appearing to Abraham, but we find that recorded many times in the Bible that Jesus showed up, and he disguises himself. They don't know who he is. Why does Jesus do that? Well, the Bible seems to indicate that no one can see God's essence and live. So God disguises himself when he comes to earth, or else we would be dead. And God also disguises himself that he might be seen by only those who look upon him with eyes of faith. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about being people of faith. Our hearts should be positioned for faith so that we can be wise and aware of the presence of whom we share. We need to be wise people, understanding of those whom we are around. The writer of Hebrews said, "Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some have unwittingly entertained angels," which is a very interesting scripture. There was a poor boy and his mother that sat down one night to eat their dinner, and they sat, as was their custom to do quite often, they set an extra place at the table in honor of the Lord Jesus. And by, as they were getting ready to eat, a ragged old man knocked at the door and asking for some food. And the mother was about to turn him away. And the little boy said, "Perhaps the Lord could not come himself, and therefore sent the poor man as his representative." You know, little kids sometimes can put us in our place with what they have to say. Well, something like that is happening in this story. Only the Lord didn't send a representative. He came himself to Abraham as a normal traveler. And the story reveals that Abraham was a very gracious and hospitable man, being very kind to these visitors that came to his home. However, in this opening chapter, we find here, I want you to notice that God reminds Abraham once again that he is going to have a son. We've seen this over and over as we've studied through here. And he said, "Behold, Sarah, your wife shall have a son." Sarah was listening in the tent door, which was behind him. And now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in age, and Sarah had passed the age of childbearing. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, "After I have grown old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord, being old also?" And the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, 'Shall I surely bear a child since I am old? Is anything too hard for the Lord? And the appointed time I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son.' But Sarah denied it, saying, 'I did not laugh,' for she was afraid. And he said, 'No, but you did laugh.'" Well, this reminds me of the story of the comic strip Peanuts. All of you have read it, where Lucy holds the football for Charlie Brown. You've seen that comic strip many times, and she always pulls it away at the last minute. This particular time, she promises, "No, this time it's going to be different. I won't pull the football away. And so Charlie backs up and he runs, getting ready to kick the football. Sure enough, once again, she pulls it away. He falls flat on his back. And Lucy says, "Charlie Brown, your faith in human nature is an inspiration to all young people," is a remark that she made. Well, Sarah is not going to try to kick that football again because she feels like God has pulled it away too many times. God has promised over and over, and seemingly to her, that it has never taken place, and now she's really old, and it's an impossibility for her to have a child. And you figure Abraham was positioned, as we're speaking about today, he was positioned for faith, but Sarah hadn't had the encounters with God like what Abraham had. And so he recognized these men as divine messengers with supernatural abilities and knowledge. And in her weakness of faith, we find that the Bible says that she laughs at the thought of being a mother at almost a century old. And you and I would probably laugh too, or you would, you ladies would. But the bad part of it is that she lies about laughing. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that this morning because I have a lot of ground to cover. But I would like to emphasize the statement here, is anything too hard for the Lord? That was a statement that was made after she laughed about it. And if the answer is yes, then I'll tell you what, my friend, then the world shuts down, the universe is closed, and God is no longer God. If the answer is yes, is anything too hard for the Lord? But if the answer is no, then the world is in his hands and the possibilities are endless. If our God, if there's anything too hard for the Lord, no, there's nothing too hard for our God. Our God is a big God. So let's get into the meat of the message here today. First of all, we find the urgent reasoning. In the remaining part of this chapter 18, you find an interaction that was urgent reasoning between God and Abraham. In verse 22, we will find the reasoning of unrighteousness. Verse 20 through 22, it says, "And the Lord said, because the cry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grave, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the outcry against it that has come to me. And if not, I will know." Then the men turned away from there and went toward Sodom, but Abraham stood before the Lord. So these other men leave, and God stays there with Abraham. And as these men or these angels disappeared over the hill, God is standing there and he is conversing with Abraham about what he is about to do with Sodom. They're having a discussion about it. And its hideous sins there in this region of Sodom and Gomorrah were so offensive that the stench of it had reached up to heaven itself. And as a result of that, God himself came down to investigate what was taking place. Sodom must have been viewed at this particular time as a very popular vacation spot, maybe a show place, a success story in the then known world, in the world's eyes, that is. They probably bragged about how that they had been rebuilt after the Great War of Genesis chapter 14. But it sounds like some of the cities in America today, I would tell you, that are known for their sin. And they brag about the greatness of their sin. One that we know of that in America, they just literally go ahead and call it what it is, Sin City. Because that's what it is. It is Sin City. And they seem to be proud of the fact. But my friend, listen to me. Every city, every country that ignores God and ignores God's law, there is a day of reckoning coming. It's going to come. You might not think it will. You know, we live just short periods of time, and you think, well, nothing is happening. It might not be happening right now, but it will happen. And we're going to witness this in the next chapter of what happens for people that ignore God and continue on in their sin. However, God is sharing these things about Sodom with Abraham. I would tell you that God is omniscient and God is sovereign, and he doesn't have to have Abraham's permission in order to deal with Sodom. But he did. He conversed with him. He discusses these things with Abraham so that his chosen man will see the reasonableness of his actions, that he's a reasonable God. We know our God is a reasonable God. We know our God is a merciful God. We know our God is a God of long-suffering, and he is. And so God is conveying this to Abraham. Second of all, we find the reasoning of righteousness in verse 25. Far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked. This is Abraham talking to God. So that the righteous should be as the wicked, for be it from you, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? So we know the story of what happened here. I'm going to spend a lot of time on it, of Abraham reasoning with God. If there be 50 righteous there in Sodom or in this region, God don't destroy them if there's 50 people there. And to move along very quickly, he asked if there be 40, if he asked if there be 30, if there be 20, if there would be 10. And even though he knew that there was not 10 righteous in Sodom, he's asking God to spare them. Abraham is what we would call as an intercessor. That's what he is doing here. He's an intercessor. There's other intercessors in the Bible. You study through the Bible. If you want to do a study this week, write down all the intercessors that you know in the Bible. I mean, men like Moses, and you remember how Moses was an intercessor. He begged God not to kill the people, you know, because of their sin. He was an intercessor. Samuel, Elijah, Jeremiah, the apostles, the Lord Jesus Christ himself, the greatest intercessor of all. But Abraham, he's crying out to God in the behalf of these people that God will spare them. And our God is a merciful God, and he is long-suffering, but there comes a day when God's long-suffering and his mercy has run its course and judgment must come. The Bible already tells us, we know the future, that that will transpire with this world because of its sin. America, in her arrogance, thinks that she's going to get away with aborting and killing millions of babies, that is God's gift to man. She thinks that she's going to get away with this. Otherwise, why would people vote for it? Why would our politicians press it so hard that we abort our babies? But I submit to you that there is a day of reckoning coming. The Bible says that there will be. Billy Graham once said, if God doesn't punish America, he'll have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, and so very, very powerful statement. But thank God for intercessors like Abraham. George Mueller, I think of the man, many of you remember him from Great Britain back in the 1800s. He was an intercessor. He constantly went before the Lord in behalf of orphan boys and girls who were entrusted in his care. You know that thousands of boys and girls came through the home that he took care of them. And often they didn't have enough food or supplies to care for the hundreds that he was caring for. But you find George Mueller crying out before God. I would encourage you to read a book by the biography of George Mueller. Have your children read the book. But he would tell God, God, you are the father of the fatherless. God, this is your work, and aren't you bound to take care of these things? And God, don't allow your glory to be diminished by a half-believing church in a wholly unbelieving world. Those were the kind of statements that he prayed to God. And of course, we know Mueller was an intercessor, and he prayed earnestly, believing that God would, and God did do miraculous things. It's astounding what God did. And I just wonder, church, what would happen if we had an entire church that interceded on the behalf of this lost community? You know, I wonder what would happen. Or what would happen if our whole church really started praying, earnestly praying and begging God for that one that we have committed to the Lord this year in our Who's Your One? I would just wonder what would happen. Listen to the words of Charles Spurgeon. You say, and one of the things that we're going to emphasize this fall as we come into Who's Your One, thinking about our one, is one Sunday, we're emphasizing very strong prayer. Prayer is a very important key. Are you still praying for year one every day? That's important. Charles Spurgeon once said, if they, lost sinners, will not hear you speak, they cannot prevent you from praying. He said, do they jest at your exhortations? They cannot disturb you at your prayers. Are they far away so that you cannot reach them? Your prayers can reach them. Have they declared that they will never listen to you again or see your face? Never mind. God has a voice which they must hear. Speak to them, and he will make them feel. Though they now treat you despitefully, rendering evil for your good, follow them with your prayers. Never let them perish for a lack of your supplications. Isn't that powerful? What a powerful statement. Abraham reasoned with God for the sake of the people. Verse 32, it says, then he said, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak but once more. Suppose 10 should be found there. And he said, I will not destroy it for the sake of 10. So the Lord went his way as soon as he had finished speaking with Abraham, and Abraham returned to his place. And then we move on to our second point today, and that is the ugly reality. The ugly reality. Chapter 18 ends with the urgent reasoning of Abraham, who was the friend of God. Chapter 19 begins with the ugly reality of Lot, who was the friend of the world. What a contrast. First of all, in verse 1, we see the reality of sinful pleasures. It says, now the two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. Now, what in the world is a man who says he loves God doing in Sodom sitting in the gate? What in the world is he doing? I mean, to sit in the city gates means that he had become one of the chief rulers of the city, is what it meant. The people brought their concerns to the city gate where all the leaders were there, and they gathered and they gathered there for discussion. A lot of times settling disputes and things of that nature. And so these leaders are in the gate of the city, and Lot happened to be there. Now, Lot, supposedly a man of God, is a leader in this city that's given over to moral perversion. And the reality of sinful pleasures is they may begin small, but they will grow like a cancer. We all know that. If you've been saved any length of time, you know that that is true. I mean, we've observed Lot's slow but sad downward spiral. If you look, first of all, he in the Bible, in chapter 13, he looked at Sodom. And then later on that chapter, it says he lived near Sodom. And then we get to chapter 14, he lived in Sodom. And then by the time we get to chapter 19, our first verse here, he ruled over Sodom. Isn't that amazing how the progression takes place? Or maybe I should say digression. But maybe when all this started with Lot, he didn't mean to harm himself or didn't mean to harm his family, which he did, which we're going to see in a little bit. But maybe he thought he could do some good with these pagans. Maybe that was his thinking. And besides, there's nothing intrinsically wrong with living in a sinful city, because we have many good Christians that live in San Francisco today. However, motivation makes all the difference. I'm telling you, it makes all the difference. Some people go to the mission field of wicked cities because God has called them there. The same way that God called Jonah to go to Nineveh, that was a wicked place. However, there are others who go to wicked cities because they loved the world and they love its attractions. And that's the reason why that they go. Lot seems to belong to this latter category. And Christians, I'm telling you, we need to learn from this lesson today, because the Bible is very clear when it says, do not love the world and the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. That's a strong lesson for us as Christians to learn today. And then down in verse 4, we see the reality of sexual perversions. The men of the city, the men of Sodom, both old and young, all the people from every quarter, surrounded the house. And they called a lot and said to him, "Where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us that we may know them carnally." Now, angels in the skies of men, we know the story here. They came to Lot's house, they came to Lot's town, and Lot takes them into his home. You can imagine what it was like when he saw them, that he quickly pulled them inside. He knows what his city is like. He quickly pulled them inside, only to have the men of the city demanding that they come out, so in reality, to be very frank with you today, so they could commit homosexual rape on them. That's what the Bible is saying. And from this shameful episode comes the word sodomy and sodomized to describe both the sin and the perpetrators of these homosexual acts. And so all the men of Sodom, with their hellish passions of flame, call out to Lot to allow them to sexually assault these nice-looking visitors who had come to this wicked town. It has to be one of the most vilest, most degraded, and holiest demands that could be issued from the lips of men. And with what decency that Lot had, you say he had any? Well, not much, but he begged the men in this city to go away. But their satanic-driven lust drove them to an even more demanding position. It was to it hyped up and drove them that much even more. And I promise you, these men had come out of the closet and they were making their demands of their sin to be accepted, much like what we're witnessing in our day and time. It's a demand that you're going to accept my sin. And if you don't accept it, we'll put you in jail or we'll destroy you. These wicked men were open, aggressive, an insistent force in the city, and which dared anyone to get in their way of what they believed and what they wanted to do. Does that sound a little bit like to you like where we are in America today? I would tell you it's exactly where we are. There's no question about it. There's a new attitude in our world today towards sin. There's a new attitude. There is a gray area where it seems like sin is not that horrific as we once thought it was. And that's what Satan wants you to think. That's what the world wants you to think. It's not that bad. You know, who are you? Are you some fuddy-duddy? Young people, listen to me. The Bible's still true. I don't care what the world, do you really want to follow the way of the world? The way of the world is destruction. The way of God is eternal life. I want to follow what God says. I want to follow the truth of Scripture. And I'm going to tell you that there are so many churches today that are compromising on this subject. I was talking with my son yesterday, and I said, "Son, would you have ever believed that we are seeing the church of Jesus Christ, or churches that call themselves the church of Jesus Christ, begin to sink so quickly in America?" You probably don't realize it like I do, because I'm involved, I read articles, all these things. And folks, I'm telling you, we're coming to a dangerous place in America in our churches. We are. We're coming to a very dangerous place. We're facing a lot of issues among even our Baptist groups and our Independent Baptists and our Southern Baptists. We're facing a lot of issues that are dangerous issues that we're dealing with. And it's a concerning thing. But the compromise of many churches on this subject we're talking about today is a pitiful shame. And I think that it is putrid in the nostrils of God. I don't think God likes it. And there are even churches today that we know of, you know of in America, that have homosexual pastors. But hear me when I tell you, God is not accepting those kind of churches. The world might say that he does, but he doesn't, my friend. You just read this story here, or go to Romans chapter 1 and see what God has to say. The idea today seems to be that you can become a child of God and you can continue on in your sin. That seems to be kind of the idea, even of some that sit in our pews today. But God says that this is not possible And this city of Sodom is an example of that fact. It's not a possibility, my friend. Paul asked the question, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? And so, my friend, when you got saved, God changed you. If you truly got saved, and the harlot who came to Jesus, she went away no longer to be in that business anymore. You'll find that the publican who came to Jesus, he left the seat of customs and he gave up that which was crooked when he came to the Lord. And I could go on and on about that. And you might try to say that we are living in a new and day and time. That's what a lot of people say. I'm talking about Christian people, so-called Christian people. We're living in a new day and time. But my Bible tells me, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Yes, we might be living in a new day, but I'm afraid that it's Sodom and Gomorrah all over again. That's what we're facing. And here are hundreds of men inflamed with lust coming after the visitors, these visitors that had come into their city. Now, here's an alarming thing. This is very alarming. Lot had been a friend of Abraham, who was a friend of God, and Lot had been traveling compassion, and he confessed his faith with Abraham's faith in God. But can you imagine why that Lot is calling these wicked rapists brethren? He calls them brethren here. And worse than that, in response to their lewd cries, Lot does something that's even more horrific. It's horrible. In verses 6 through 8, he offers to give the mad mob his two virgin daughters to do with them as they will. Now, Lot was willing to sacrifice his two unmarried daughters to the lust of the crowd, but the angels intervened. You might think that this is horrific, but we have so-called Christian moms and dads today that allow their daughters to dress and to act sensually and let them go out on dates with worldly men. And my friend, is that much different than what Lot did? I ask you, is it that much different? You know, and these are people that are in the church. And to give Lot just a small amount of credit, it was almost sacred in that period of time to show hospitality and protection to those who had come as guests to their home. But I submit to you that Lot placed the sanctity of hospitality above the sanctity of his home, is what he did. And oh, to God, I'm telling you, Christians, we're coming to a day that we're going to have to fight by tooth and nail for everything that we believe that the Word of God proclaims. And oh, to God that we have more dads and moms in America today that would say, as Joshua of old that said, as for me and my house, we're going to serve God. I don't care if they come and lock me up in jail. I don't care if they come and take my life. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to live for God. I'm not going to let anything stand in my way. Which brings me to our last point, the ultimate reckoning. And I love reading John Phillips. I like the way that he describes this. He's very analytical in his, and he likes to illustrate good illustrations. But he says here, the unholy morality of Sodom was prevalent, polluted, persistent, and a pugnacious thing. It was also a punishable thing, not by the laws of Sodom, perhaps, but certainly by the laws of God, is what he said. And yes, the day of reckoning came, but my friend, I will tell you, it always comes if people can persist in their sin. First of all, we find reckoning because of corruption, there in verse 24. And the Lord rained brimstone and fire on Sodom and Gomorrah from the Lord out of the heavens. So he overthrew those cities, all the plain, all the inhabitants of the cities, and what grew on the ground. So Sodom and Gomorrah was so sinful that God destroyed their cities and all the plains around, And I will tell you, Abraham could see it from 20 miles away. He's 20 miles away, but yet he sees the destruction that is taking place. Why did God destroy Sodom and Gomorrah? Very briefly, give it to you quickly. Because they were utterly given over to moral perversion. That's the reason why. The sexually perverted society that had run its course, and God was no longer going to allow them to practice their shameful sin anymore. And my friend, if society and law will not deal with sinful behavior, I'm here to tell you that God certainly will, and he did. The Bible shows us that he did. Second of all, because God is warning the ungodly. It says in Jude 7, as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in a similar manner to those, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Number three, because God wants to show mercy and to help others. That is, God. If God didn't deal with Sodom, then that wickedness would spread throughout the rest of the world. And God wanted to stop the wickedness, to keep it from spreading. Number four, because the righteous failed to make a difference. And how sad that is. You know, I don't want that indictment to be upon the people of Winter Haven Baptist Church. The righteous people failed to make a difference. Righteous Lot had no effect on Sodom, but Sodom definitely had an effect on him, as we're going to see in our next point. And that next point is reckoning because of conformity. There in verse 26, but his wife looked back behind him, and she became a pillar of salt. Now, Lot and his family were told to get out of town before God's judgment falls, and they were told specifically not to look back. You know, I wish I had time to talk more about this. They struggled with leaving because Lot and his family were more concerned about preserving their wealth and their status there. They had both wealth and status in town. They're going to leave it all. They didn't want to leave it all. And years of rationalization, and that's where we are, Christian. Be careful. Be careful, because you and I are going to get caught up in this if we're not careful. After years of rationalization and compromise, it had stolen Lot's ability to use reason. And he no longer possessed the ability to be able to distinguish of the difference between losing comfort and losing his life. He can distinguish it. He no longer can do that. And the angels that had come to Sodom, they literally had to drag Lot and his family out of town. That's what had to happen. Lot didn't take God seriously. And that's what happened to you when you compromise and listen to the ways of the world. And once they got out of town, Lot's life couldn't resist. She glanced back and looked at her city of Sodom. And I say that very specifically. Why would she do that after God told her and told them not to do that? She had become so attached to her comfortable way of life with her friends that she didn't want to leave. That's where she was. And we have Christians today who say that, oh, I'm looking forward to the return of Christ. You know, and that really frustrates me, of people that say that. And yet they have become so comfortable in their nice homes that they can't even make it to church on Sunday. But, oh, I'm looking forward to the return of Christ. But yet they're too comfortable in their homes. Or they become too comfortable watching television on Wednesday night that they can't come to connection groups to study the Word of God. And yet when Jesus comes, I'm here to tell you that they're going to leave behind their lovely homes and their very interesting TV shows. They're going to leave it all behind. But the wife looked back in verse 26, but his wife looked back behind him and she became a pillar of salt. This is what happened when she didn't take God seriously. This is what happened. How many of us take God seriously? How many? Jesus used her as an example later on, as you find Jesus talking in the book of Luke, chapter 17. Jesus said, likewise, as it was also in the days of Lot, they ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built, But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even so will it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. In that day, he who is on the mountaintop and his goods are in the house, let him not come down to take them away. And likewise, the one who is in the field, let him not turn back. Remember Lot's wife, whoever seeks to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life will preserve it. My friend, there's coming a day when God's going to rapture us out of here. And what a sad day that will be for those who are left behind. That's prophecy. We won't get into that today. But Jesus is reminding us not to fall in love with this world. That's what he's reminding us of. And the world is temporary, and God's kingdom is forever. And it says in verse 36, thus both the daughters of Lot were with child by their father. The firstborn bore a son and called his name Moab, he and the father of the Moabites to this day. And the younger, she also bore a son and called his name Ben-Ammi, and he is the father of the people of Ammon to this day. Now, this is an ugly picture. It's an ugly picture of what happens when you follow the ways of the world. It's an ugly picture. Yeah, I told you, the Bible tells it like it is. Everything's in there, what takes place. The two daughters of Lot were worried about being isolated from the world. They ignored God. They ignored the laws of God. And they got their dad drunk and had sexual relations with him, is what the Bible tells us. And you might say, oh my goodness, why would they do such an awful thing? Well, look at our society. You think that's so awful? Look at our society and where we are today. I'm going to tell you, we are accepting in America, and we're forced to accept, or trying to be forced to accept, all types of sexual perversion that is taking place. It's happening in America. I promise you, with the laws that are changing in the direction that they're going now, you'll find soon probably the legalization of polygamy and also even sexual relations with minors. You're going to see laws that are going to change in these ways. Why wouldn't they? If everybody can do what they want to sexually, you know, why wouldn't they change? Why wouldn't the laws to let everybody do what they want to do? These two daughters had no shame, no sorrow, no sense of sin, no concept of the holiness of God. They had none. And as a result, hear me now, Moab, their sons, Moab and Ammon were born, and from them sprang up two nations who became the bitter and persistent enemies of the people of God. That's what happened. Sin has its consequences. It always does. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap. Let me give you the four final thoughts that we need to learn from this today. Number one, the seductive power of sin begins with small decisions. Remember, Christians, because we're making small decisions sometimes. Hopefully you're not making small decisions of the world. Second of all, moral compromise always has a deadening effect. Number three, God's day of judgment may be slow, but it is certain, as we see in the scripture here. Number four, there's a horrible cost to pay for living in two worlds. It says in verse 29, and it came to pass when God destroyed the cities of the plain that God remembered Abraham and sent Lot out of the midst of the overthrow when he overthrew the cities which Lot had dwelt. Now that the mess is all cleared up, God visits Abraham and gives him new hope and excitement as he and Sarah joyfully anticipate and look forward to the coming of their son that is going to be born. However, Lot lost everything in Sodom. Everything there is destroyed, and he is saved, yet so as by fire, as it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. While it is true that the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah is an example of God's righteousness, it is also true of God's love for lost sinners is clearly seen in this story. And this is the way I want to end my message today. I want you to hear me very clear, because I've been very direct in this message. I've been very strong in what the Bible has to say. But I want you to understand, in this story, God showed long-suffering towards these people as he was willing to listen to Abraham's intercession and consider sparing Sodom and Gomorrah for just 10 righteous people. God said he would. The angels of God came and they couldn't find 10 righteous people, but they spared Lot and his family. Did he deserve to be delivered? Of course not. Do you and I deserve to be delivered? Of course not. We don't deserve it, my friend. But the most amazing thing is that Jesus came and he died for sinners. Those like those who lived in Sodom and Gomorrah, that's who Jesus died for. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Jesus didn't die for good people, because there are none. He didn't die for good people. The Bible tells us that there is none righteous, no, not one. Romans 3:10. Jesus died for the ungodly. Sinners like you and me. Now, we may not have committed the same sins as some of the people like of Sodom and Gomorrah, but we're sinners just the same. And apart from the faith, our faith in Jesus Christ, my friend, we will not be saved from the judgment to come if we don't put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? That's the most important thing. And I close with these verses for you who do not know the Lord. Seek him today. The Bible says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he was near. Let the wicked forsake their way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. The unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy on him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Call upon him. Seek him today while you can. Because there will come a day, my friend, it'll be too late. Seek him today because he wants to pardon you, abundantly pardon you, and give you eternal life. Will you come to him today?